Tonight's speaker, Richard, I saw in Wales at the Truth Juice gathering, and as I said, done a brilliant talk. He's got off his arse, he's gone over to Bosnia, he's done 2 years of visiting there, and I think he's going to try and sell it to you that you too can get on a plane, you go and dig on a pyramid, and have some food, and watch a sunset, and have a smoke, and have a drink, and it sounds idyllic to me, so I'm going to leave Richard to do the talk. As I said, with respect, telephones off. 40 to 45 minutes, and we'll ask questions at set points rather than randomly. If you feel your arm rising, just ignore it. Yeah. So this is Richard on Bosnian Pyramids. Thank you very much.
Cheers for you guys. So this is my, I think this is the third time I've spoken in front of people, so if I get a little bit nervous, bear with me. Okay, so I studied geology at the University of Leeds, and in my second year at university I became interested in alternative ideas, alternative theories regarding the primarily the Egyptian pyramids. And in my third year I took myself to Giza, and I was basically, with the books that I'd read, I wanted to see for myself if what they were saying was correct. Having my geological skills, I was able to confirm a lot of the things that were spoken about, for instance, the difference in the erosional rates between the blocks that were covered and weren't, so there's a change in the age. And when I got back from that trip, I was randomly Googling something, I can't remember what it was, and I came across the Bosnian pyramids, and I was like, oh, pyramids in Bosnia? So I clicked on Google Images to have a look at it, and immediately, there was no doubt in my mind that this hill that they claim it to be is artificial and it is a pyramid. But I had a lot of questions, so I spent about an hour and a half writing an email to Dr. Samir Osmanagic. He's the doctor who discovered it in 2005. And so I wrote this email for about an hour and a half. Lots of questions, how does it fit into ancient world history, so forth. And he just sent me back an email saying, oh, it's probably easier if you just come for yourself. So I was having a lot of synchronicities at the time, so I literally just went on the internet and booked my flight, and the rest is history, so to speak. Okay, so the first image I want to show you, this is the Pyramid of the Moon at Teotihuacan, prior to excavation. As you can see, it's not angular, it has trees and bushes growing on it. This isn't unusual. All the pyramids in South America looked similar to this before they were excavated. And there's hundreds, if not thousands, of pyramids in the Amazon rainforest that are still buried. And this is what it looks like, the same pyramid after excavation. This is modern day. So the Bosnian Valley of the Pyramids, it's based around a town called Visoko, which is about 25 kilometres northwest of Sarajevo, the capital. And it's quite a small town. Surrounding the town are at least five large pyramidal structures. There's a total of nine potential structures in the area. But for this talk, we'll focus on these structures here. And you have the main pyramid, which is the Pyramid of the Sun. This is the one, if you've seen it on the internet, you're probably familiar with. It's the one with the triangular northern face. Opposite, on the other side, is the middle-sized pyramid, the Pyramid of the Moon. And then there's a crescent moon-shaped structure, which is called Temple of Mother Earth. It's not strictly a pyramid, but it has two pyramidal faces. Very unusually shaped structure. Next, behind the Pyramid of the Sun, is the Pyramid of Love. And far back you have the smallest of the pyramids, which is the Pyramid of the Dragon. Okay, so first we'll talk about the Pyramid of the Sun. This is the tallest of the pyramids, possibly the tallest pyramid in the world so far discovered. Well, it is the tallest pyramid in the world so far discovered. At least 220 metres in height. We haven't been able to pinpoint the base of it yet because we haven't excavated, so it could potentially be as much as 270 to 280 metres tall. You can see from this picture that the west side, is it's not, you know, flat, and this is because it's built into the side of a natural hill formation. And this is one thing very particular about the Bosnian pyramids. They are not like any other pyramid in the world. They are completely unique structures. And what we find is all three of the largest pyramids don't stand alone. They have a access plateau, we call it, which leads to about the top two-thirds of each of the pyramids. This pyramid is, as well as being the tallest in the world, if we compare it to the Pyramid of Giza, which is 147 metres, it's one-third taller. But actually, volume-wise, it's a total 39 times bigger than the Pyramid of Giza, because it's not a flat, square base, it's actually rectangular. So volume, we're looking at least 2,300 million tonnes of material. This is a photograph from the Axos Plateau to the peak of the pyramid. And this plateau is also artificial, constructed from concrete and clay blocks. So when Dr. Samir originally was in Visoko and discovered the Pyramid of the Sun, when he started his scientific investigations, the first thing in which he did was he used satellite thermal imagery. And he was able to identify the structures because of their different heat signature compared to surrounding hills. And the reason for this is simply because pyramids have got hollow spaces inside, so they heat up quicker because of the hollow space. And what he did was he took this thermal anomaly, and he also plugged in the fact that he wanted to look for hills with at least two pyramidal faces, and nine structures came up around Visoko. Here we have an image of satellite topography analysis showing the sites. So, since excavating started in 2005, a lot of the critics have said, well, if it's a real pyramid, why don't you start at the top? That would be the most sensible place to excavate. You could excavate all four corners and it would be pretty obvious. Well, the reason for that is our beloved European Union. Because at the top of this pyramid, there is a medieval fort, a ruined medieval fort. And the European Union has decided to put a site of special scientific interest on this fort, which means that no one is allowed to dig below two-thirds the top of the pyramid, where all the interesting things are. So these areas located in red are the excavation sites so far. For the last 2 years, we've been concentrating on the lower left-hand side. This is one of the excavation sites, as I said, the lower left-hand side. You can see here, this is the surface of the pyramid. It's not like you'd expect from Giza. In fact, the surface of this pyramid is covered in concrete. And what you can see here is one of the single layers of concrete, close up. Each layer is about a metre and a half thick. In between each block is 15 centimetres of clay, and this goes on for five layers of 1 metre thick concrete. The outer shell, I think, has a total mass of 60 million tonnes. That's estimated. And one of the reasons why they perhaps used clay for construction of this pyramid was because clay is great for thermal expansion and contraction in changing temperatures, so you wouldn't get cracks. Also, if there's any tectonic activity, each layer of concrete can move relative to each other, sliding back and forth with earthquakes, seismic waves. So in 2006, Dr. Samir invited some geophysicists from Belgrade and a German university, and they used georadar, and they were able to detect clearly man-made hollow spaces under the surface. And we marked these off. There are 44 areas near to the surface which have been indicated to be hollow passageways. The georadar can only penetrate, I think, for this model, maybe 6 to 10 metres at the most. And this is where they marked them out here, so we can virtually walk the path of the tunnels. Another piece of high-tech evidence that was gathered is satellite radar screening. Here you can see this is the peak of the pyramid, and these are several of the passages running around and underneath the structure. As well as the georadar, seismic refraction, reflection, were also used. So we have several different scientific methods to gather the same results, and this is important that we can repeat the results. This was one of the most important geophysical investigations. This Dr. Professor Oleg Kavroshkin, he's investigated the pyramids of Giza with his techniques, and he, with his results in Bosnia using these same pieces of technology, he was able to confirm that the Bosnian signatures are exactly the same as the Egyptian pyramids. So the concrete on the outside, the sceptics will say it's just a natural rock composition conglomerate deposited in the Miocene. This Miocene is 4 million years old. We need to remember this date because we have evidence collected which disputes this. So it was investigated, the material, at six different institutions, and they all came back with the same conclusions. Dr. Joseph Davidovits, this is his image that he created. He's the gentleman who put forth the theory that the Egyptian pyramid blocks were actually manufactured from some kind of poured concrete material. And he's come to the same conclusion that this material cannot in any way whatsoever be natural. It is a man-made geopolymer. Here you can see the same excavation site. This is a group of Malaysian PhD archaeology students, and they were here for Bosnia for 6 weeks last year. In fact, one of their professors from the university believes in the project so much he bought a big chunk of the Pyramid of the Moon for himself. So what is the concrete made from? Well, nearby there is a local natural conglomerate, and we will discuss this later because it's an important site. Basically, what they've done is they've taken old riverbed stones which have been deposited by various flows of rivers, and they're small rounded pebbles, and they've been mixed with calcium carbonate and clay. Now the clay which has been mixed with it has been analysed to have been found to have been heated up to temperatures exceeding 500 degrees. And the reason why they do this is because when clay is heated to that temperature, its properties change and it becomes more of an adhesive. And so this binds the material, as well as the calcium carbonate, it creates a very strong binding material. So, from what I've gathered, is that the sections of concrete were poured in maybe several tons worth, talking maybe 7, 8, 9 tons each. And they'd pour one section, they'd allow it to set, and then they would pour this liquid calcite material in between, and then pour another layer on. And the reason why I see this is because when you make a sandwich and you've got some mayonnaise and you put two slices of bread together, you get those gloops coming from dripping down the side of the bread. And this is exactly what you can observe along the lines where this crystalline material is found. Once it was a liquid, it was squeezed together by the two blocks, and then it came out to the top. This is just on the right-hand side of the other previous sondas that were excavated. Again, concrete blocks, which you can see here that the sections, when they were poured, they were in some kind of mould, and you can see completely flat face on one side. On the top, because there wasn't anything pushing the material down, it was all bumpy and raised. But on this side, completely flat. And it's important to note this, because a conglomerate, because it's made up of mixed compositions of stones, each stone has different erosion rates. So if this was a natural deposit, you'd get some stones eroding quicker than other ones, and it wouldn't be this perfectly flat rock, especially if they're saying it's a 4 million-year-old deposit. This is the layer below the one you've just seen, and again, you've seen exactly the same thing, a flat face on the blocks, which just wouldn't be found in a conglomerate such as these. Same slide. So when these concrete samples were analysed, not only did they confirm that it was concrete, but in actual fact it's a higher quality concrete than anything we can make today. They did stress tests and found it to be as much as 5 times stronger than the best quality concrete we can make today. Now, when we take our best quality concrete, it will last no more than 8,000 years before it breaks down into its constituent parts. Whereas these pyramids, we'll get onto the dating in a moment, far surpass 8,000 years, and yet this concrete is still managing to retain as much strength as five times more than our concrete. So another piece of evidence that has been found is the vegetation on the pyramid. And one botanist, biologist, came... Just losing concentration. Biologist who came identified that the species on the pyramid are completely different from the surrounding plants. It's more of a Mediterranean climate on the pyramids, and the reason for this is because of the thermal anomaly of the hills. Because they've got hollow spaces, they warm up quicker, and so there is a 5 degree warmer climate on each of the pyramids. Another interesting observation is that the trees growing on the pyramid, if you take the same species of tree and see it growing in a naturally deposited conglomerate, these tree roots can penetrate as much as 20 to 25 metres down through the ground. Whereas the trees on the pyramid of the sun, once they hit that concrete layer, they start growing horizontally. They cannot penetrate the concrete because it is so strong. So, ages of the pyramid. Well, unfortunately, we cannot conclusively age the pyramids yet. There isn't enough physical evidence for us to get a conclusive age. But we can give us a ballpark figure. And one of these pieces of evidence we do use is the pedological study on the soil deposition. We can calculate how long it would take soil to build up on the pyramid from natural processes. And they estimated an age of 12 to 15,000 years. So this doesn't tell us when the pyramids were built, but what it does do is give us an age of possibly when the pyramids were allowed to be taken over by nature and they were disused, when they were forgotten. Another interesting anomaly is surface water runoff. Every hill, when it rains, the water has to get down to the bottom, and so it will leave streams, brooks, that kind of thing, where the water is running down. In the centre you have the pyramid of the sun, and either side you have natural hills that have pyramidal faces. And what you'll see is the surface water tracked and mapped out. And you can see that the pyramidal sides on both of the two, on the left and right, have surface water runoff. But the pyramid of the sun on the undamaged sides has no surface water whatsoever. It seems that the structure of the pyramid is drawing the water in towards its centre, or somewhere inside the pyramid, and it's being channeled away. We'll get onto that in a moment. In fact, we'll get onto it here. So this is one of the excavations this year on Pyramid of the Sun, and what we found was these channels within the clay layers above the concrete, and you can see this here. So we believe this is what is causing the fact that there's no surface water runoff. They've purposely developed a water system which draws the water from the surface and down set routes. Okay. Oh, is there any questions so far, by the way?
So you've got those, the water running. Is there somewhere you can see where the water's going?
Yes.
Right. You're going to get there, aren't you?
Yeah. Is this concrete being reproduced today?
We cannot manufacture this concrete. The best concrete we can make is nowhere near as strong.
It seems funny, sort of heating up clay. If you heat clay, get pottery, and then what would you do? I mean, how would you get that?
Well, when you're heating clay up, I don't think you're heating it up to the temperature we're talking about here. It's not as hot as 500 degrees centigrade. But Joseph Davidovits is in the process of trying to reproduce the concrete he found at the Pyramid of Giza, and he hasn't had any success yet. He's got close, but he hasn't been able to manufacture it exactly. So I don't think we would be able, currently, we wouldn't be able to either with the Bosnian concrete.
What sort of, how do they tell that it's been heated up to 500 degrees?
Okay, when you take a thin section of a mineral, you can see how it's been metamorphosed by heat, by the way the minerals are shaped. And you can see the borders, and it can tell you how hot the material has been heated up to. Okay, so here you see the Pyramid of the Sun, Moon, Dragon. and what this forms is an almost perfect equilateral triangle. There's about 2% error between the different sides. It's pretty close. And each pyramid is 2.2 kilometers apart from each other. Another interesting thing about these specific alignments of the pyramids. If you were to stand at the second highest peak behind the Pyramid of the Sun and look in a straight line over that peak, that line would take you to an entrance to the underground tunnel network running underneath the Bosnian Valley of the Pyramids, we call KTK tunnels. Also, another straight line from the Temple of Mother Earth intersect through the Sun-Moon intersect, that line will take you exactly to the same place. If you stand on the highest peak in the area and look over the second highest peak, that straight line will take you to the very centre of the Pyramid of the Sun, of the triangle. The highest points of the Pyramid of the Sun, the Pyramid of the Love, and the Temple of Mother Earth are all on the straight line. And if you take the distance between the Pyramid of the Sun and the Pyramid of Love, it is 1/3 of that line's length. This is some more evidence we've gathered for to understand the site and the locations of the objects. This was helped to be produced by Tony from Templar Mechanics, who does sacred geometry. I don't know if any of you are familiar with that website. And what he did was he highlighted all the areas of natural highs in topography. These ones highlighted are just the important ones we're dealing with. But he tried to get alignments between them all, and he was able to identify these places that had a very interesting alignment. You see here the two axes between the lines. I must stress that this map is just a section of a much larger map. You see these points as spot heights here, but there's a lot more also aligned to these lines off the picture. So if you connect the two points here, this is Setnica and Sesa Hill, it produces a northeast-southwest axis, which also creates the baseline for a triangular shape. Now this is the starting point for sacred geometry because the angle, base angle of this triangle is 51.5 degrees, which is exactly the same as the Great Pyramid of Giza's base angle. Also the northwest-southeast line creates the midpoint line there. These circles, very important. This is the Earth to Moon ratio here. If you enclose in the first circle the two base points, and you create a larger circle to take the peak of the triangle. The outside circle is the centre point for, if you take the distance between the outside circle and the inside circle, that's the radius for the circumference of the moon compared to the Earth, which is the inner circle. As you can see, the triangle and the points produce a base for sacred geometry to be perfectly created. And what we find here is that along the points, the pathways, the churches, the mosques in the area all adhere to the positions of the star points. And it produces the pentagram. This the orientation of the pentagram is actually the top of the pentagram is pointing southwest. And at the centre point, you can see that, maybe you can't see, but at the centre point, all the contours of the map are converging. And this is indicating where there is an energy vortex, where the surrounding topography and the energy is all at one and it's been moulded. And the pyramids, you can see, are on the shoulders of the pentagram. You have a pentagram touching the Pyramid of the Moon. You also have the bottom of the bottom pyramid triangle touching Temple of Mother Earth there, indicating it's an important site in the area. Another alignment, I insist you go home if you've got Google Earth and try this for yourself. If you create that equilateral triangle and you take the midpoint line between the dragon and the moon and extend that line, you will find that it aligns with the Pyramid of Giza. Just a coincidence, just a hill. Nothing to see here. Another interesting alignment, again, all these alignments should demonstrate that these aren't just random hills placed. Nature can't produce hills with such specific and numerous alignments. On the top photograph you see the sunset of the summer solstice, and the shadow created by the pyramid of the sun creates an equally sized shadow compared to the pyramid of the moon. It matches its height perfectly. And 2 months later, in August 21st, the shadow is produced, which completely covers the moon exactly to the peak. Okay, so the second pyramid that I will discuss is the pyramid of the moon. This is the second biggest pyramid in the area. It's 190 metres tall, which makes it still much larger than the pyramid of Giza, although it might not look it here compared to just being stone in the sun. The construction of the Pyramid of the Moon is very different to the Pyramid of the Sun. We're not seeing the huge concrete blocks. We're finding a much more fine kind of construction technique. It's close to a step pyramid in that it has different layers. And these layers are built up between carbonatic sandstones, clays, and more carbonatic sandstone blocks, tiles. What you'll find is, you can see here in this picture, each tile, block, slab is a different shape. Now you see this kind of building technique in other ancient sites in South America and in Egypt. And the reason for this is to make it earthquake proof. If you have, instead of having flat faces on each other, they'll just slide about if there's any tectonic activity. These will actually interlock with each other and hold together and make the structures a lot more strong. Also you see, a lot of people say, oh, this is just a natural river, but this is just a natural deposit here, you know, it's just sandstone, what's to see here? What you can see here is a step, and every 5 metres this step is reproduced very accurately, and each step is the same height. Now, why this step here? We're not so sure. We know that the Pyramid of the Moon is radial in that it creates some kind of spiral, and each side is dipping inwards towards the centre of the pyramid at about an 8-degree incline. No matter which point you are on the pyramid, it will be going inwards towards the centre in a spiral-like fashion. And perhaps maybe these are ways of catching water, again, pulling the water to within the centre of the pyramid. You can see here the different shapes and sizes of the blocks. What they did was the ripples. These aren't actually the original ripples when the rock was deposited. This is a cast from the other bed. So one bedrock, the layer of rock below, would have the ripple marks on it. And after that was solidified, they would then deposit more material on top. And you're seeing the cast of from the layer above. And then what they did was they turned these blocks upside down. And we can tell this because of the strength between the blocks. The hardest part of the rock is on the base, and it gets softer at the top. So they deliberately turn these blocks upside down so that the hardest surface would be towards the top. The excavation site we just saw there was the yellow arrow. Where we'll go next is the red and then to the blue. Again, you see here the same material, carbonatic sandstone. It's on the same layers as the other sandstone blocks you saw. But it's dipping 8 degrees again, but in a different direction. Again, still towards the centre of the pyramid. And you can see that it's got the straight lines there as well. And this is what we call Sonda 20. It's perhaps one of the most impressive excavation sites we've got on the moon so far. This is what it looked a bit untidy when I first arrived in June last year. But we tidied it up. You can see here that these are... Hopefully you can see that these are manufactured blocks and this is in a natural formation. You can see more here, and the shape of the blocks are very specific, creating patterns there. Again. How these blocks were made? Well, it has an inner core of carbonatic sandstone, and they also place a capstone on the top. And around it, there's on all four sides, there's a mortar-like material. Below that, again, you can see clay, more blocks, clay, more blocks, clay, and it continues from the bottom to the top in this fashion. You can see you can see here in this photo, around the four sides of these blocks, you have this mortar-like material. Nature doesn't deposit things horizontally, it would be vertically. So how this material could go equally on all four sides is, you know, it cannot be a natural process. This is found at the top of the pyramid of the moon. There's a farm at the top of the pyramid. The guy must be the luckiest grower in the world. And he was looking for a well so he could, instead of travelling down to the bottom of the pyramid, he could find his water source here. This was before pyramids came about, and or the idea of pyramids. And what we found was that at the top, it alternates between, instead of having sandstone and clay, we were actually finding sandstone blocks, clay, concrete blocks, clay, sandstone blocks, clay. The composition had changed. You can see the well goes down about 10-12 metres. You can see in the top right the changes between the blocks and the clay layers in between. We took a core sample 50 metres below from the top of the pyramid, and you can see a border between the sandstone and a concrete layer there. Another structure just outside of the Valley of the Pyramids is a tumulus called Ratnitsa. This is only maybe 1 or 2 metres shorter than Silbury Hill, so it's almost as large. And this is very much like the Pyramid of the Moon. It's conical. It also has a spiral. It's composed of mainly sandstone blocks and clay. Again, we are finding concrete, but not as much as on the pyramids. Same sandstone as the Pyramid of the Moon, same ripple marks. Here you can see some of the largest blocks that we've excavated. The largest one we found so far is estimated to be 24 tonnes, so they are quite considerable. Okay, no excavations have been carried out on this structure so far. This is Temple of Mother Earth. It's a very unusual shape. It's like an amphitheatre crescent moon. It's particularly high. And actually, when you're at the top there, the sides are extremely steep. For me, this is the most intriguing structure because it's got pyramidal faces, but it's not a pyramid. And I haven't seen anything like this before, so I really want to get my hands on it and see what's under there. And the smallest, it's still a considerably large pyramid. This is the Pyramid of the Dragon. Again, no excavation work has been carried out here. The Pyramid of the Sun Foundation is drastically short of cash at the moment, and they can't really even afford to pay their lead archaeologist. Okay, any questions before I lead on to the next part of the subject?
Are you saying that sandstone is cast? That's not real. Are you saying sandstone or concrete?
The concrete's been cast. The sandstone, for me, is a natural bed that has been cut, taken away, and then replaced on the pyramid. But they turned it upside down. So, what is the function of the pyramids? Okay, I'm very much a believer of several of the alternative theories. I do not accept the theory that they were tombs. And this section will explain with evidence why it's a good reason to think that it's more than a simple megalomaniac's tomb. Dr. Harry Oldfield, familiar with him? He's the gentleman who photographed human auras with his electro-scanning PIP camera. And he visited the Bosnian Valley of the Pyramids. And he took a photograph. This is a photograph of a regular hill nearby to the pyramids. And you can see that the scalar waves of the Earth are roughly horizontal. This is what is expected to be found everywhere around the world, horizontal scalar waves. However, when he turned his camera to the Pyramid of the Sun, there was almost a 90-degree change in these waves. So what we're seeing here is clear interaction between the structure and naturally occurring scalar waves. So, Orgon, this is essentially one of the functions of the pyramid. Every ingredient in an Orgon device is found in the pyramid. You have crystalline structure, you have conductive material, and you have insulative material. The conductive material, perhaps the clay, which has got more electrocapacity than a concrete or a sandstone. So you have the relative changes between insulation and so forth. This is a physicist, Professor Slobodan Mrstrak from Zagreb University. And he came here 3 years ago. This is a photograph of him on the tumulus. And he brought with him just some standard measuring equipment from his physics lab. He didn't have to modify it in any way. And he was able to detect a beam of electromagnetic energy at the top of both the tumulus and the pyramid of the sun. This electromagnetic beam was resonating at 4.2 kilohertz, right up to 28 kilohertz. And it's far too specific for this to be a natural phenomenon. The beam on the pyramid of the sun is roughly 5 meters in diameter, and you can generate an electrical current from this electromagnetic beam. At 1 meter above the pyramid of the sun, you could generate 30 millivolts. At 3 meters, that jumped up to 4 volts. 10 meters, you would be drawing hundreds of volts. This is a photograph of the center of the pyramid of the sun's EMB. Another gentleman, his name slipped me now, Davor, he's from Croatia, and he came this summer to investigate the electromagnetic beam. Here he brought his own custom-made antenna. Because he'd taken results from the previous study, he was able to customise his antenna to specifically seek out the frequencies that were being detected in the previous study. And it just goes to show that if you know what you're doing, you can literally use anything for groundbreaking scientific research, because I think he took his mum's favourite china and stuck some tinfoil, and he got a regular MP3 player, cracked it from software on the internet, and downloaded his own spectrum analyzer system. And we repeated the experiment. We took it to the pyramid of the sun and the tumulus, and the electromagnetic beam was present. And we actually got some very interesting results. The electromagnetic beam was actually jumping between frequencies. And Davor has some interesting theories as to the reason why this is and what its function is, which I can discuss in a moment. Also, you see team members of SBRG, which is an Italian research group. And they came to the pyramids for is to record the ultrasound that the pyramids are emitting. It's not just electromagnetism. The pyramids are also generating ultrasound, which incidentally is coming out at the same frequency as the electromagnetism. These are separate phenomena, yet they are still choosing the same specific frequency, which is, for me, very unlikely to be chance. Goran Majonovic, the third scientist to come again, he came with a custom-built antenna and receiver, and he was investigating both the ultrasound and the electromagnetism. In his study of the tumulus, you can see here, this is live results, at the top of the pyramid, touching the surface, it was generating 4 volts per meter. Now, you can get 4 volts per meter when you hold this device in front of a television, and there is no television or electric wires or anything producing this kind of voltage in the area. So the phenomena has to be coming from the object itself. The antenna that Davor was using with its shielding was designed to only detect waves perpendicular to the antenna. So the only way you can measure these beams is by holding it like this and the beam coming up and hitting the antenna. So the travel.
Yes, that's good. Yeah. Has anybody done that at the pyramids? The pyramids of Egypt done this sort of thing? Electromagnetic.
You know, I read about some kind of electric energy beam at the top of Giza. But like a lot of things on the internet, you have to remain sceptical until you can prove for yourself, and so maybe there's some credence to that theory that there is any theme, why wouldn't there be?
But you don't know anybody that's done any measurements.
I can't say
personally.
I can't say personally. No, they're very protective about anything that would smash the paradigm.
Yeah.
I was just. I lost where I was going.
Sorry.
It's alright. No worries.
Do you try any other hills of control?
Yeah, we did, both for the ultrasound and the electromagnetism. We stepped away from the tumulus with the equipment and the beam had gone. It's very narrow area, like 5 metre diameter roughly. Yeah.
What would be the normal reading compared to what you're seeing there? Just put a bit of context here.
This device here, when we moved it away from the pyramid, it dropped down to zero. He also had a device that could measure tesleons as well,
yeah.
And this was different between on the tumulus and away from the tumulus. A lot higher readings on the tumulus. So this is another investigator. I have got the sounds afterwards. If you want to hear the sounds of the pyramids, come and ask me and we can try and play them. But we also recorded ultrasound and infrasound inside the tunnels underneath the pyramids. The tunnels I'll get onto in a moment's time. And we used a top-of-the-range Sennheiser mic and digital recording the software and computer analysis. In fact, the tunnels are so quiet that we had to use a computer to remove the sound of the microphone. It was picking up the electrical circuits. I think we'll take a break now and we'll come back in a moment's time. Okay, so getting back into it. You've seen the pyramids around the valley. But also, as is with all the other pyramid structures around the world, there is an underside to the structures above the ground. As above, so below. And 2.5 kilometres away from the Pyramid of the Sun is the entranceway to the underground tunnel complex. The tunnels run for hundreds of kilometres because, as you'll see in a moment, there are literally dozens and dozens and dozens of different routes to take. It's a kind of like labyrinth when we get in there. Here you can see the position we are looking at compared to the Pyramid of the Sun. We need to excavate these tunnels because you can't just go in and freely walk around. At some point in the past, maybe it was the principal point of the tunnels, or maybe it had a different function and was filled in later. But they've been blocked up with loose material. And so since 2005, all year round, we've been removing this material by hand. As you can see, we haven't got very far. The objective is to reach the Pyramid of the Sun. Because the European Union's put that digging ban on the top two-thirds, where the entrance is to be found, we've decided to use the tunnels in order to get into the pyramid. And this is one section of the tunnels. You can see it is cut into a conglomerate material. Now this is the same material that the concrete is manufactured from. So we haven't got any conclusive evidence yet, but because of the compositions, we are quite confident that in order to create the concrete, they first created the tunnels underneath the pyramid, and the material that they removed, they then created the concrete and built the pyramid. So it's a very ecological construction technique. They literally took the material underneath the pyramid and just moved it a few metres on top of the pyramid. So it wouldn't change the Earth's natural energetic field too much. This is one of the walls of the tunnels. You can see the banding, the different layers. This is because of the flow rate of water. More energy in the flow of the water means that the material can be bigger, it can be transported with bigger mass. The smaller particles means the water energy is less. And so we're happy to say that this was a natural river deposit. Now this is what the end of the tunnels looked like last summer. You can see again the banding in the walls of the tunnels, but the material in the centre of the tunnel blocking it is a different is different in that you cannot see any banding. There isn't any structure within the deposition. If it was deposited by water or natural processes, you'd see the banding. Here you don't. It's just been shoved in. We're presuming by the pyramid builders or maybe a later culture who wanted to hide potentially what was inside the pyramid. Although it was it's a grand task of removing this material. We move maybe 1 meter per day. So in order to block the tunnels up completely from the floor to the ceiling would have been an exceptionally difficult job to do. Here you can see, because of the size of the tunnels, we can only have maybe one or two people working at the front. This is why it's such a slow work to progress. Another piece of evidence to prove that these tunnels aren't either filled naturally or created naturally is that when we are moving forward through the tunnel excavating material, we're coming across these dry stone walls. And these are created from a single composition of rounded riverbed sandstone. And they're stacked on top of each other. And they actually mark the junction point between the main tunnel and side tunnels, which are running 90 degrees to the main tunnel. Here is another example. This is one of the largest ones we've found in this section of the tunnels. You can see behind it, hopefully, that there are two tunnels coming off behind this side wall. Again, all the side tunnels are blocked up just like the main tunnel is. And we have different shapes and sizes of these side tunnels, potentially having different significance symbolically or functionality-wise. You can see in the centre of this round dry stone wall there's a square block with a flat face, which is unusual because most of the blocks they use are rounded. And this is a picture of one of the side tunnels where they removed the dry stone wall and tried to empty it. As you can see, well, the scale of this is maybe 60 centimetres at the lowest point. In other words, it's too small for a person to be walking in and up and down these tunnels. For me, the tunnels serve as a technological function rather than one for transporting people doing ceremonies. I'll go on to that in a moment where I think so. Basically, this is where what we do with the material. Once we've removed it, we take it outside. We have people looking through the material. There have been one or two minor artifacts discovered, but by and large, it's just the stone material. So another piece of dating evidence, in the side of the tunnels, which preserved in a vacuum, we were able to find a piece of wood which was carbon dated at three different institutions, giving us an average age of 34,000 years, plus or minus 5,000 years because of the margin of error. And this date of upwards to 39,000 years, again, it doesn't give us the exact age of the pyramids, but what it does do is it gives us another date to work with. And we can say that the material that was there to create the pyramids and the tunnels was deposited 40,000 years ago. So now we have two dates to work with. We have 12 to 15,000 years and 34 to 39,000 years. So objects that we found within the tunnels. This is about 80 to 100 metres into the tunnels. We call it the egg-shaped megalith. Megalith, not the right word, but the Bosnians used it and it stuck. This is a sculpture. It's a poured material. It's not a natural sandstone. It was once a liquid. It was poured, set into this shape. And what was interesting about this object is that through dowsing and georadar, we found that underneath, below, there was an underground source of water running in the same direction that the egg shape is pointing towards, which may serve as some significance, because later on they discovered a second object. The first one was 1 ton, and this object here is 3 tons. Again, they found an underground source of water running below. And the third object they found, this is called the K2 megalith, and it weighs 7 tons. Again, same material, poured, set into this specific shape. What they found under the largest of the megaliths was that instead of there just being one underground flow of water, there were actually two flows, and they were intersecting each other directly underneath the centre point of this object. And the crossings of the water potentially create an energy vortex, and this object may be interacting with this naturally created vortex. Inside the object, they used georadar, and they found a hollow space with a metallic object inside it. So potentially what we're seeing here is some kind of ancient technological device. And here you can see that it's sitting on a plinth. So they specifically chose this location, almost certainly because of the crossings of the water. Now, I mentioned that those megaliths were pieces of technology, and okay, they don't look like technology that we know of. But another thing that was found was that in the tunnels, at the closest towards the megaliths, the concentration of negative ions was up to 40 times higher than outside fresh countryside air. And so we believe that maybe these megaliths are interacting with the water underneath and creating some kind of ion exchange between the atmosphere and the water running below. Now, where is this water running from? Almost certainly it's coming from the pyramids themselves. Because in December this year, we found a section of the tunnel, December last year, sorry, we found a section of the tunnels that were completely unblocked. They didn't have any fill material, but what they did have was channels of water. Also, the dry stone walls were different. Instead of them just being rounded sandstone, they also had compositions such as granite, basalts, and limestones. They were much bigger as well, much grander, and they weren't actually marking side tunnels. They were more like supports for the walls. And this is why I think there's functionality in these tunnels rather than just a place for transportation, because where you don't have these huge supportive dry stone walls, you have the fill material, and the filling material is bracing the walls apart, whereas in these areas where there's water, there's the dry stone walls instead holding back the walls. And I think it was this close-up of the dry stone wall, and I think these sections are important because it allows prolonged contact between water and the atmosphere, so ionic exchange between the atmosphere can occur, because we're discussing Tesla technology. This beam of electromagnetism at the top of the pyramid, if you look at Tesla's rainmaking machine, how that functioned was that it was a tower, and it had a huge voltage pump through it. It was more high powered than a pyramid, but essentially what happened was there was a charge differential between the atmosphere and the top of the tower, because the groundwater below the tower was pulling away these ions, and so the atmosphere was the water in the atmosphere was being attracted to the top of the tower. And this is what I think these tunnels are for. They're actually there to pull away the water from the pyramid and create this ionic exchange between the water and the atmosphere, so we have this differential at the top of the pyramid. You'll also notice that in the centre of these channels, some people, sceptics, say, oh, this is just natural, it's just natural caves. You can see in this photo here that there's a channel, a deeper channel, a cut, a groove into this tunnel. And you can see this is a photograph under the water, underwater orbs as well, that's pretty cool. And this channel stays in the middle of the tunnel, even round the corners. So again, nature cannot do this. This was purposely designed this way. This is accurate mapping with theodolite we did this summer of the tunnels so far excavated. The purple mark off side tunnels, and the yellows mark, I think they mark dry stone walls as well. The water tunnels I've just shown you run off in this direction and this direction. And the direction of the pyramid itself is over here somewhere. It's about 2.5 kilometres worth. So I was talking about the exchange of ions between the water and the atmosphere in the tunnels. And Well, if you compare the form of the tunnels, which seem pretty random, if you put it over an alveoli of the lung, the shape and form is quite similar. And the reason why alveoli is the shape it is to create an efficient exchange of gases between the body and the lungs. Going back to the triangle, with georadar and seismic reflection data, they also found that each of the three pyramids had underground sources of water that were actually meeting each other in the centre of that triangle. So the idea is that these channels were artificial and they were collecting the water from the pyramids for some purpose. Now, if you're familiar with the theory that if you put positive emotions into water, you can program it, and likewise negative emotions program it. Well, the pyramids, they are different shapes, different size, different materials, and so potentially each pyramid can charge one of its water sources different from the other one, and then they're collecting these three different types of charged water to use maybe for the benefit of health rituals. This is one of the natural springs, well I say natural, this is one of the springs coming out from Temple of Mother Earth, and truly, as James will attest, it is the tastiest water I've ever had. James?
It's the best.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's really something to...
Anything could be better than what we get.
Yeah.
Crystal clear, ice cold water, isn't it?
Yeah. So we call this guy here the Machiner. This was a local miner who worked around the corner in a local town around the corner from Visico. And he's worked in the mines all his life, so he's a digger. He knows how to dig and what he's doing with being underground. And he was working for 3 weeks, and he made the observation that how his endurance in the tunnels wasn't normal. He was able to, literally, he was start morning, he would dig, and he would continue without a break right to the end of the day. And he made the observation, you know, I'm 60 odd and I couldn't do this back in the tunnels. I couldn't do this in the coal mines. What's special about the tunnels? And the negative ions, for one, a great hangover cure, because you go inside there and it really does remove the fog of your mind. You go in for half an hour, and you're coming out buzzing. Your mind is just running as fast as it possibly could, and I believe it's because of, not because of the energy, but because of the negative ions. Although the energy does have some impact, because they also, guy from Slovenia called Pelko, he brought with him a curling camera, which is a replica from what Russians used. And what you're able to do with it is put each of your five fingers inside the camera, and it recreates with computer software the whole aura of the human body. And what he found was that out of 70% of the people that went into the tunnels and worked for 5-6 hours, 70%, when they came out, had a stronger aura than when they went into the tunnels in the morning. And usually you would expect the auras to be less strength, have less strength, because if you're working and exerting all day long, you're going to be losing your energy. But that wasn't the case. Okay, any questions so far? Yes?
Did anyone out of the water you're going on, did anyone actually analyze it to see whether it was having any calcium phosphate?
The analysis that was done is that absolutely pure, clean, 100% drinkable water. Yes. No, and also there was no bacteria.
No minerals in it.
I can't remember the mineral analysis, but from what I understand, the mineral content wasn't anything special. It was just like any other water in the area.
Yes.
Bacteria.
Yes.
Do you know the tunnels were filled?
Yes.
Did you get an age of how long ago they were filled up?
This is what we're hoping. We're hoping to find some carbon that we could hopefully date. The problem is that the wood that we did have was sealed in an airtight vacuum in the wall of the tunnels, whereas the conglomerate is a lot looser and it's not airtight, so there is chance for decay to occur. So we might have lost any valuable evidence in that case. Okay, yeah. So this is one of the latest discoveries that was made in July this year. A team, SBRG in fact, had brought along a georadar, and what we did was we scanned the floor of the tunnels because we wanted to see if there were any underlying structures or indeed if there were any other tunnel systems beneath the ones that we'd found. And at this location here, you can see X marks the spot, we found this very unusually shaped object. And it's 4 metres totally.
3x is meant to be in light.
This is hollow space here.
Right.
This here is false image. And also at the top it's false image. So
what does false image mean?
It's how the computer analyses the data that's coming back, because it cannot compute certain angles, so it creates a false image.
So are there x's there?
Well,
is it just the 1x if that actually exists?
Potentially, this may actually be a reflection. If there's water in the sediment below, then maybe, then this is a reflection. But if there isn't water, then it means that this is a true image as well as this one. So we have two diamond shapes with hollow spaces.
Is that something in the middle of the second
gold?
Yeah, potentially there is an object. But we know that there's air inside these tunnels, inside these objects, which means that they're completely sealed because no water or anything has been able to get inside and fill them up.
And this is the temple of the...
No, this is in the tunnels. underneath all the pyramids, 2.5 kilometres away.
Oh, right, okay.
Leading to the pyramids. Yeah. Really? This is the image from the detector, non-ferrous metal in the cavity. So, where the rectangle is, this is the location of that structure. And we started excavating. The plan was to create our own tunnel, because the workspace in the tunnels is very small and we had to dig to a depth of 4 metres, we needed to enlarge the space. So the plan was to create our own tunnel connecting two others and to dig downwards to create a ramp to this structure. Like so, this is the new tunnel that we made. And well, after we'd gone maybe 3-4 metres into the wall, and we were maybe another 2 metres away from reaching the other side, we found this object. As you can see, it's completely different from the surrounding material. Rather than it being a rounded riverbed deposit, it's an angular, rectangular, well-faced sandstone block. And so we slowed and we wanted to see what it was, and we cleared around it. And we found that it was what may look like here, a careful, just a pile of stones, but these have been specifically arranged in this way. This object actually turned out to be in the middle of a roughly egg-shaped chamber. And what we'd actually done is accidentally found a new chamber that had been previously undiscovered, which looks something like this. Here you can see it has 5 minor tunnels and 1 major tunnel. This would be potentially where people could access this chamber before it was blocked off. As is with all the other side tunnels, they have a dry stone wall marking it, but these are smaller than the rest of the dry stone walls. In fact, they're smaller side tunnels. They're only 30 centimetres in height, which is why I'm pretty certain that the function of these tunnels isn't for people to be walking up and down. Again, here is another one. You see the dry stone wall around the side tunnel and the fill material inside. Can't quite see it. There's 2 more side tunnels here and here with the object in the centre. Okay, the critics, they'll also say that there aren't any artefacts that have been discovered before. This is just a blatant lie. This was found in the tunnels, And if we take the lines, we can actually compare them to lines of topography in the local area. This could potentially be an ancient map of thanks.
How would you dig a 30 centimetre high tunnel? How would anyone dig that?
It's difficult.
You can't
see. Well, I have a theory about the actual material in the tunnels. I will say it now that you brought it up. Basically, if you look at the Pyramid of the Moon, and you look at the clay layers in between the sandstone blocks, the clay layers look like they've been deposited by nature. They're very finely laminated. It's not something that we could would consider to doing when constructing something out of clay. We just have a blob, one big layer, and then another layer. But what they've done is they've deposited each layer of clay in these thin layers and then put another block of sandstone on top. And so one of my ideas is that, well, if they can do this with the clay material, which is fine grain, very fine grain material, why couldn't they do this kind of building material with coarse grain? And perhaps this conglomerate that the tunnels are cut into have actually been created artificially, the same as the rest of the pyramids. And it's there are a few pieces of evidence confirming this, but again, this is right at the beginning of the research, and we really have so many more questions than answers to give. You know, it's difficult. This is an artifact found on the tumulus, and it looks like it was used to cast metal. The inside of the moulds actually have a glaze of a different material to the stone, so it looks like they've been pouring things in which have tarnished and adhered to the stone there. And this small stone, it's only about this big here. It was found in the tunnels this year. Under a microscope, this triangular shape, you know, it was cut by a very sharp and accurate object. It wasn't just random marks created. The angles on this pyramid is 51.5 degrees. Again, another object found on the tumulus. May represent a human foot. But it's not just pyramids in Bosnia either that is strange. The Bosnian country doesn't have any archaeologists, or if they do, not very many. They rely on the European Union to send their archaeologists to carry out field studies. And they've got into a habit of anything that doesn't make any sense or they want to play down, they'll label it medieval. So what you're looking at here is a medieval stone block. And if you ask them why, what did they make them for, you don't get an answer, they don't know. But these are found in strata below the medieval layers, so clearly they are older. And they're similar to the stone spheres found in, Costa Rica? This one here is made out of a sandstone. We have others made from basalts, limestones, granites. This one here is a sandstone that hasn't been excavated. People, when they're digging the foundations of their homes, are often pulling them out of the ground. So I think there's about 60 so far uncovered, but there's going to be a lot more found. And actually, they're not perfectly spherical either. They're bulging in the centre, like a planet or a star, which it may represent symbolically. Another site, this is 100 kilometres south of the pyramids, huge megalithic blocks on top of a mountain or a hill. Again, you can go here, it has a fence around it with a European Union badge saying they're looking after this site for archaeological research, which isn't the case at all, because you can walk to this area and happily pick up ancient Greek pottery from the surface and put it in your pocket. There is no interest in sending archaeologists here to carry out an investigation, almost certainly because they don't want anyone to think, oh, hold on a minute, this isn't medieval. So I was talking about other pyramids in the area. This one I came across last year. It's about 4 kilometres south of Temple of the Dragon Pyramid. And as very important is that, again, it's orientated north, south, east, west, like every other pyramid. And you can see the similarities in shape between the moon, this is Pyramid of Moon, and this pyramid. You see here, there's this strange bulge as here. You also see a rise here and a rise here, just like on the Pyramid of the Moon. You have a convex and a concave and then a convex movement in the land. This is a freestanding pyramid behind Temple of Mother Earth, again orientated north, south, east, west. And you see it's got a bulge, a convex, a concave, and then a convex. I include this for anecdotal because it's yet to be confirmed. But this summer, Klaus Donner came to the pyramids and he was happy to stamp his approval. He was very impressed with what we found. This is me and him in the new tunnel we discovered. But what he brought to us was, he says he has a friend working for the US military, and he works with satellites that are searching for deep underground military bases. And rather than sending a satellite here, there, they're retasking it every time. They would send a satellite around once and it would map the whole world in a decaying orbit. And all this data then sits on a computer somewhere until someone needs that area analysed. They pull it up, analyse it. And so this data for this area was just sitting on a computer. And he asked if his friend could analyse it and give us some information to the makeup of the Pyramid of the Sun. And this is the image that he produced for us. As I say, we've yet to confirm how accurate this is. I don't see why he would make anything up like this. But what is interesting from this map is that one of the closest set of tunnels to the surface of the pyramid is spiral shape. And this is a repeating pattern that we're finding both on the Pyramid of the Sun, the Moon, and the Tumulus. Now, why is it a spiral shape? Well, some of the physicists that have been here to measure it have suggested that potentially what we see here is a ginormous coil made out of natural materials, and this is inducting a current, and we are finding a perpendicular current at the top of the pyramid and the tumulus, so it does make sense that this would be a spiral-like shape. Okay. So, why are they saying it's a hoax? You know, first of all, if someone's crazy enough to say it's a pyramid and it's a hill, you wouldn't waste any energy on that person. You would laugh at him and you'd say, all right, yeah, it's a pyramid. It is a pyramid, and there's so much evidence that it is a pyramid compared to the evidence that it's a hill. If you were to speak to any of the archaeologists that have made famous quotes such as it being a cruel hoax on an unsuspecting public, they cannot produce any field work. They've never been to the site. To carry out a scientific investigation, you need field work, and they do have none to show. They've literally created a few articles and spouted some harsh remarks, usually discrediting Samir and ignoring the countless other scientists, archaeologists that have visited the site and concluded the same thing as himself. What we see in this photograph is Dr. Samir, some of the archaeologists and volunteers, and this is the local mayor of Visoko. And I met with him in the town hall, and he was very supportive of the project. He funds the project, and behind closed doors, he believes that there's pyramids, but as soon as there's a camera crew in front of him, it's all natural. It's not a man-made structure, and he boasts about his architect degree and how he was a professional architect, and yet for some reason he's too scared to say that it's man-made when there's a camera there. This is the medieval fort that they're reconstructing at the top. In fact, most of this is reconstructed. The fort had been all but demolished, and
why is this? Pardon? No one asked him why he says that. Samir asked the mayor why he says that.
Yeah, why is there something in private and then says it's natural?
Because, probably because of external pressure from the European Union.
No one's actually asked him.
I'm sure they might have, yeah. I didn't ask him because he's a politician, so I'm not going to get a straight answer for them. But yeah, so this is the reason why we can't dig to the entrance on the top of the pyramid. So the story is that in 2005, before Samir came to the Visoko Bosnian Valley of the Pyramids, no one knew of pyramids in Bosnia. This is a painting of a medieval crowning of a king. And could you just kill the lights a second?
Oh,
so you can get a good image of this. Cheers. Behind the crowning scene is a pyramid, clear as day. Also,
Oh, cool. I was looking up before we did.
Everyone happy that is a pyramid? Yeah. Behind the king. This is the flag of Bosnia with a triangle on it. Pyramid. They're playing jokes at us. And another interesting thing I found out this year was that before World War II, all Bosnian passports had pictures of pyramids on them. Again, was there foreknowledge of the Bosnian pyramids before 2005? The official story that we're given, the narrative, is that before Dr. Samir discovered the tunnels in 2005, the entrance to the tunnel was a cave, and it was used by the Yugoslavian army as an ammo dump and for training purposes. When we started excavating for the structure, we found these pipes, and it turns out that these pipes, which are about 120 metres into the tunnels, were placed there in the 1960s by... Oh, you can see the pipes here. They were placed there in the 1960s in order to find an underground source of water, just randomly in the tunnels. And they were put there by this factory here called KTK. It's one of the biggest industries in the area. And on the grounds of this KTK factory happens to be another entrance to the pyramid tunnel network. And they supposedly didn't know it was a tunnel system, they just used it as a hole to dump industrial waste there to keep people away. As the same as with the Yugoslavian army based at the other tunnel entrance. So perhaps somebody knew something we didn't from a long time ago. And it makes sense because military technology is what we know of is far advanced than what we know, sorry. And so the technology that Dr. Samir was able to use in 2005, the thermal imaging, the military had access to that a long time ago. So it makes sense that, you know, people in high places will have access to this knowledge. Could I have the lights off again, please? So these were first found, they were only seen in the tunnels once we breached through to the unsealed sections of the tunnels. And in this photo they may look like blurs or smoke, but in actual fact they moved around people, swirling and disappearing at will and then reappearing. And it wasn't smoke because when we were breathing, there's actually some videos on YouTube of this. When you were breathing out and you could see vapour, the vapour was moving in a different direction to these objects here. It's very interesting.
Like a snake.
Yeah. It's pretty weird. And you are familiar with orbs. This was something else though. I don't quite know what that is. And this is another one of my favourite orbs that I found in the tunnels. Every time you go in these tunnels and around the pyramids, the orbs are ruining pretty much all of your photographs. Very cheeky. And actually, when I first came to Bosnia, I was a skeptic of orbs. I hadn't really dealt with them or read much into them. And a few people working on site were convinced that these were balls of energy, interdimensional entities. Really out there theories. I heard some of the theories were mind-bending. But I had the time to recreate the conditions, or try and recreate the conditions, because if it's dust or water, that's what skeptics say. I tried to put dust and water and all kinds of things in the same location. All my photos, I'd make sure that there wasn't any dust falling or water dripping. And absolutely, the area in front was clear as day and these things were popping up. So I'm sold by these things, whatever they are. Any questions? I'm coming to the end of my talk now on anything I've covered.
What do you think the orbs are?
I really don't know.
Didn't see anything there, so when you took the photo,
On the Pyramid of the Moon, I was able to see them with my own eyes. The sky was full of them, but that's the only time I've seen them on the Moon Pyramid. Everywhere else, I only see them afterwards.
They were in the sky?
Yeah, all over, in front of me, in the distance.
So about the naming of the pyramids again.
Yeah.
Is it meant to be
personally discussed? Dr. Samir named them, the Pyramid of the Sun and the Moon, because of their relation shadow-wise. They match the same as in the South American pyramids. The dragon represents knowledge, and Temple of Mother Earth, because he wanted to bring into focus the fact that as a race we're damaging the planet, and because this project is so international, these pyramids belong to all of us, all across the world. He wanted to put a focus on the planet Earth, so he named it. And the Pyramid of Love, his reason being that he wanted, wants to create a positive energy in the area, which is very positive.
I just those medieval pictures, I just seen that there seems to be a bit.
What I'll end with saying now. Oh, my question.
Can I have two questions?
Yeah, sure.
First one was about the diamonds.
Yeah.
Is there any plans to go deeper?
I'm returning there in January, and
cool.
We're going to start excavating.
Cool.
Fine. Yeah.
And my other question was, when are you going to take it away? Go and put a big, new tunnel in there.
Yeah.
Are you worried that you might be kind of affecting, it's been built for a purpose.
Yeah.
And
well, I'm trying to be very diplomatic.
Yeah.
I don't want to be too negative on this talk, but obviously it's a destructive method of investigation. It wasn't my idea, but it's how it is. It's almost a little bit desperate, in fact, that there's no money now. So the foundation's struggling, and we need to continue the work. And so it's any means necessary, really, to find something so substantial that it can't be just pushed under the carpet. Any question?
Is the oldest known civilization from around the area as old as possible findings within the pyramids?
Academic history will say that no one lived in Bosnia until 3000 BC. There's some Roman cultures in there as well. The oldest acknowledged civilizations, Sumeria, at a push, at the end of it, is about 8,000 years. So this massively predates that. Even if you take the youngest dating that we have, the soil buildup, predated by 2000
years. That would blow our common belief with regards to civilization.
Again, this is another reason why academia is so against this project. It literally changes absolutely everything we accept now, currently, about our history.
I couldn't quite understand where that wood was. You say it was in Conglomerate, was that in what? Is that in what you thought was natural?
Basically, the conglomerate that the tunnels are cut into, when that was deposited, wood had also been deposited along with the stone material that had fallen into the river. If it is a natural deposit, it had fallen into the river and then deposited along with the stones. And then it gets sealed in a vacuum, it's airtight, so it doesn't biodegrade. And that's where we're able to take it. And
so that doesn't really tell anything about when the tunnels were cut into the
river. No, it doesn't. But it does give us a date between when the pyramids were made, because if the pyramids are made from that conglomerate material, they had to have been made after they were deposited. Mm-hmm. So we can say between 12 and 40,000 years.
So the earliest could have been as 40?
The earliest, yeah. But if the idea that the conglomerate is an unnatural deposit, it's actually part of a structure, then we don't know the upper age. We could say that it's the day that it was manufactured at 40.
So you're saying there could be an unnatural conglomerate out of which they made the cement?
Yeah. Well, they might have used the same source of material, both of this and the tunnels. You see, what's the conglomerate itself is permeable, and it allows water to travel through the conglomerate. But underneath it, there's a marl. And one idea is that as water is falling through the conglomerate, it's actually pushing this negatively charged water up through the ground, and you're actually creating soil, which is then superb for agriculture because of the negative ions we enhance all the plants.
And you mentioned the Tesla. I mean, I don't know much about the cloudburst. It sounds more like the cloudburst, because that's not doesn't actually have to be have any outside.
Well, yeah, this is it's a lot more passive than the Tesla design. But
it's the cloudburst,
isn't
it? You come across the cloudburst one.
Yeah, it's like organ, isn't it?
Yeah, but I don't really understand how that works.
What I'll say now is this year in the summer there is a volunteer camp, and I would highly recommend coming to get your hands dirty.
That's my hands volunteering.
From June till September, anyone can come and help excavate the pyramids. This is a unique experience because usually, for starters, if you want to be part of an archaeological excavation, you need to be a qualified archaeologist. Mm. And second, it costs at least £1,000 to be a part of a digging excavation. And usually, if you watch Time Team, it's something really lame, like a few stones here, a few stones there. What we're dealing here with is a world-changing historical discovery that will blow your mind, because you will meet amazing people, and literally your mind will be pushed into other dimensions. This is my buddy James. I met him this year. Absolute legend. Was a volunteer as well. Will you come and give
if anyone's got a spare 2 weeks next year to go to Bosnia, you will not regret it, because there's a lot of things going on there that I can't explain. I'm not like Richard, who's knowledgeable about these things, but it's changed me profoundly about the way I look at the world, the way I look at the way things work, the way how the questions we were told about where we come from and who we are. This place seems to have all these answers hidden within like the landscape. And you know, just go there for 2 weeks to experience the energy, and you'll regret it for none. I went there for 4 weeks, and I'm not looking back. It's changed my whole outlook on everything. Honestly, everything. Synchronicity. You've heard of synchronicity, haven't you? Where you mentioned something, coincidence, like your name, maybe, for instance, and all of a sudden that person just appears. You know what it's like, don't you?
Yeah, it happens every other...
You mention someone's name and you turn round and they're there. It's more than bizarre. The place is... It's magic. I can't put it into no more words than that. It's magic. It's more than magic. It is.
Cheers. Cheers. Thank you.
He's sleeping in a hotel.
Oh.
It's 21st century.
Are you intending on
I don't know what I'm doing right now, because I'm doing this independently for now.
Yeah.
I've been invited to do more studies at some university in Italy.
I'm sure some universities would pick it up.
Well,
more of mine than anything.
You know, the lead archaeologist, she's from Italy, she has a PhD, she's worked as a professional archaeologist for a few years. She's only young, she's 26 years old. But she's excavated tumuli and she did a PhD thesis on Etruscan cultures. Actually, in fact, she's trying to rewrite the understanding of the Etruscan culture. So she's experienced with this kind of out there archaeology, and she's literally received dozens and dozens and dozens of emails telling her from quite high up there archaeologists that she will never work again at an archaeological dig. So for me, academia right now is kind of like the enemy, so to speak. Any more questions?
Yeah, on the photographs, where he says thank you for coming to listen, are those orbs?
Yeah, there are some of the orbs.
How do we go about signing up?
Oh yeah, if you go to
I looked on the website, there's an application form that was for this year, which is already gone, I think.
Yeah, no, it's definitely up there this year. The official website is there. www.pyramidofsunset.com. Pyramid of Sunset is spelled with an I, so
P-I-R-M-I-D-A.
Sunset, S-U-N-C-U-A.
Bosnian Pyramid Hoyle. If you take that on,
and you'll find the link to the English site, it's all translated.
That's the main site.
I'll see you in the sunset. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for coming and listening.